Welcome to the Contemporary Issues in Anthropological Theory. So today we're going to discuss about the whole wide world, the rediscovery of political economy, cultures of the world system. Welcome. So how is historical beings, human as historical beings, culture and mediation, a global market in human frailties? In this section, I'll kindly ask you to remember the process of globalization and the critique of Rawls, the critique of Karl Asser, what we have been going through from the last classes. Eric Wolff argued that the analytics of modes of production from the Marxist legacy, of course, would allow anthropologists to shift away from the study of bounded cultures and societies to that of process and interconnectedness. Mind you, one of the biggest critics was of the functionalist schools, that they were not explaining the power relations. They were not explaining the relationship of the ruler and the ruled. I guess you remember. These would enable them to trace how the world system of capital empire was forced through the historical interactions of different modes, with one emerging dominant, the structural expression of the colonization of the world's peoples. Finally, the people without history would finally be engaged as historical beings and not simply as victims and silent witness of their own subjugation. So who are those historical beings? How they have been portrayed? And who were so much powerful to portray them? They themselves or the others? If they are portrayed by themselves, how they portray themselves is crucial part. If they are portrayed by others, how they have been portrayed, this is a crucial part. Yet, as Marshall Charlins argued, the same tendency of reducing the colonized to passive objects of their own history that Wolff critiqued in World Systems Theory seems to reoccur in Wolff's own approach. This is because the question of how those who were colonized absorbed into global capital organized what was happening to them in their own cultural terms has not been addressed. After all, for people to have an active historical role, they must shape the material circumstances laid on them according to their own conceptions of history and reality, their own cosmology. But we cannot forget about the negotiation with other stakeholders and other factors. For Charlins, this was a consequence of the classical Marxist tendency of treating culture as a reflex of the mode of production, where the latter appearing to have its own instrumental rationality and necessity. This tendency, he argued, was based on misinterpretation of Marx's understanding of production as the appropriation of nature within and through a determinate form of society. A mode of production does not in itself specify a cultural order. Instead, production itself must be culturally specified to be meaningful. That's why Rawls' argument again seems very valid. Marx's understanding is coming from a very Western European understanding. So, for the colonized, therefore, their cultural assumption of external conditions that they do not create and cannot escape is the very principle of their historic action. Charlins argued that we must understand the historical expansion of the world system as a cultural process and ask how indigenous peoples made these encounters and subsumptions meaningful in terms of their own conceptions of themselves and the world. In doing so, however, we must resist the temptation to reduce the colonial encounter to that between physics, global material forces, and teleology, the destruction, corruption of local cultures. This is a dominant pattern. However, we need to see much deep. Thus, instead, we must understand the historical expansion of the world system in its entirety as a cultural process. Indeed, for Charlins, the world system itself is a system of cultural differences organized by division of labor, a global market in human frailties, gainfully transacted in a common pecuniary medium. Such a global market is made possible by capital's ability to reduce the cultural universe to market prices, translating social relations and cosmologies into the terms of cost-benefit analysis, such as fetishism. Yet, in doing so, capital remains beholden to those cultural universes, local aspirations, concept of status, and means of labor control. This is what Charlins attempts to show in his analysis of trans-Pacific commerce in the 18th and 19th centuries, involving British, American, and Australian merchants, the Chinese emperor, and Hawaiian royalty in an escalating and complex pattern of trade in tea, sandalwood, wool, cotton, European manufacturing, silver, and more. That is it for today. Take care. See you in the next one.